to tell you more about Shibboleths is Luke Swartz. So come on up, Luke.
Thank you. All right, so my name is Luke, and I'm a language nerd. And I'm going to be talking about shibboleths, or how to not get killed for saying the wrong thing. So to explain what shibboleths are, although Bart did an excellent job already, I'm going to let Martin Sheen do it.
You guys know what a shibboleth is?
It's a catchphrase, isn't it?
A cliche. It comes from the Bible. Then said now unto him, say now shibboleth, and he said sibboleth, for he could not frame to pronounce it right. It's a past word. The way the army used to distinguish true Israelites from imposters sent across the River Jordan by the enemy.
Now, I don't like disputing President Bartlett, who is my favorite president, after maybe Lincoln. But technically speaking, they were both Israelites. There were two different kinds of Israelites. One group was in Gilead, as in there is a balm in Gilead, that's in Gilead. And the other group were the Ephraimites. And says the good book, the Gileadites said shibboleth, the Ephraimites said sibboleth. So if he said sibboleth, not being able to give the proper pronunciation, they would seize him and kill him at the fords of the Jordan, and thus fell 42,000 Ephraimites. It's one hell of a pronunciation lesson. So that's the story from the Bible. And to this day, as Bart pointed out, we use the word shibboleth, among other things, to refer to a way to distinguish two groups of people, especially based on the way they talk. Right? So, and there's the word, at least I'm told that's the word, I don't actually read Hebrew, the word shibboleth there. So does anyone here speak Dutch? Any Dutch speakers? Okay, one person here, I'm sorry, oh, there's a couple in the back, so I'm sorry folks that speak Dutch here. But for those of you that haven't heard Dutch, it sounds a little bit like if you got a German guy really, really high and then asked him to speak English. So, is that true? Yeah, or kind of? All right, so does anyone that didn't raise their hands there know how to pronounce the name of this town? Yeah. Yeah, pretty close. Yes, Scheveningen. So you're like, what's it? Yeah, so one of the things that makes this hard to pronounce is that in Dutch, most CHs and Gs get pronounced ch, that thing in the back of the throat. So it's Scheveningen. It's this, you know, it sounds like you're hawking a loogie. This guy that you all know as Van Gogh in Dutch is Van Gogh, right? So that's probably why the Belgians call it Flemish. I'll be here all week. Tip your waitresses. All right, so going back to Scheveningen. Right, so Scheveningen, why is this a shibboleth? What's the point with this? So in World War II, the Dutch resistance was worried about German infiltrators attending their meetings. So if they saw someone they didn't recognize, they said, oh, say this word. And if they said Scheveningen, which is probably what a German Nazi spy would say, they would, you know, get rid of him. Right? But if he said Scheveningen, like a good Dutchman, then either he's a German that studied Dutch really well, or it's a real Dutchman. All right. It turns out we Americans also used shibboleths in World War II. So in the Pacific Theater, there were times when they needed to distinguish Japanese from Chinese or other Asians, because basically Japan invaded like all of Asia at that point. So for those of you that know Japanese, you know that there's not really an L sound. There's a sound that's sort of halfway between an, or it sounds like halfway between an R and an L. So like, my middle name is Hiro. Like, if you saw the TV show Superheroes, it's Superhero, right? Like that guy. So if they try and say Lollapalooza, it comes out something like Rara Parusa, right? So there's actually this really racist cartoon here that called How to Spot a Jap. This is a real cartoon. You can read the whole thing online, but it's developed by the US government in 1942. And you can see here how they say, tell them to say Lollapalooza, right? As a shibboleth, basically. Moving forward to the Vietnam War. So in Vietnam, there were a number of Americans, including John McCain, a former presidential candidate and current senator, who were being kept in a prison that they sort of jokingly called the Hanoi Hilton. And most of them were being kept, or a number of them were being kept in isolation, so they couldn't talk to each other. So to communicate with each other, they would tap, right? So this is this tap, so this is a foreshadowing of Ringo's talk, the third talk. We have a grid here. So if you want to say A, you would do tap, tap. If you want to say B, you say tap, tap, tap. Right? Something like that, and so forth. It's a pretty simple grid, so eventually the North Vietnamese figured it out. So the question is, how do you know if the person on the other side of the wall is an American or not? Right? So to explain it, I'm going to turn to the classic movie, Who Framed Roger Rabbit? you haven't seen Who Framed Roger Rabbit, classic movie, definitely recommend it. So they use the shave and the haircut thing, right? So let's try right now. I'll clap it out and you guys clap out the response. So there were a few Viet Cong in there, but most of you are Americans, right? So, and it turns out the Viet Cong even figured out the response was two claps, but they would never quite get the rhythm right. It would be like da 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 da, like that. It just wasn't quite right, and that was how they tell the difference between Americans and the North Vietnamese. All right, so these are all wartime examples. These are cases in which it may have literally been life and death. So what if it's more about a shibboleth that will prevent you from getting ripped off? So let's say that you're at a fancy Italian restaurant and you see this on the menu. Oh, it looks very nice. Does anyone know how to pronounce this word? Anyone out there? Bruschetta. Okay, so several people say bruschetta, right? You'll often hear this pronounced bruschetta, which is Italian for leave the restaurant. So the reason for this is that in Italian, C-H-E and C-H-I and C-E and C-I are pronounced exactly the opposite of what they look like. Right? So if you look at it, like cappuccino has no H in it. It has a C-I that's pronounced chi. This C-H-E is pronounced K. You know, my theory is all the Italians got together and said, Signore, you know, our language is too easy to pronounce. We must switch all of the pronunciation around to confuse people. So this is bruschetta. It's not a bruschetta, which is what it looks like in English. Similar one. Panini in Italian is plural for panino. So you have one panino, two panini. So if you see something like this, this is from SFO, hot paninis, right? It's probably not the most authentic place to go, right? Here's another example where they're ignorant of two languages, right? So we have hot Christini apostrophe S. This is they're suffering from the unnecessary apostrophe syndrome, which we'll get to in a second. So anyway, these are all examples of different languages in, you speak Japanese but not English, or you speak German but not Dutch, where you're distinguishing different language groups, right? But what about within a single language group, within a single nation even? So does anyone have any theories as to what this map represents? You guys are real nerds. All right, so this is indeed soft drinks, right? So in this case, the yellow or puce states are the soda states. The blue states are the pop states, and the red states are the Coke states, right? So, and for those, you know, this blew my mind the first time I learned of it, is that if you're in Texas, the following is a valid conversation. Hey, I'm going to go get some Coke at the store. What do you want? Oh, I'll have a Sprite, right? I mean, like, despite millions of dollars of advertising, 7-Up is the un-cola. In the South, 7-Up is a subset of Coke, right? So... And it's interesting that, you know, with a few exceptions, it seems like if you say soda, you're basically voted for Obama, basically. That's what it comes out as. Right? Especially because the Northwest is slowly becoming a soda territory. So what about closer to home? What about even, you know, on a subnational level? Do we have some distinguishing characteristics? And this one, I'm going to turn to Liz Lemon.
I've been to L.A. once.
Olive just turns into Barney.
Just go back to Kate.
How do I get to 10?
It's the 10.
Okay, so do we have any Los Angelinos here? All right, you can all leave. You can all leave. No, I'm kidding. So the Los Angelinos, you probably grew up calling this the 5, right? The 5. And around here, we just call it 5. Now, so we can feel smug and pretentious around the Los Angelinos. I think that at least part of this is if I say I'm going to take the 38 somewhere, everyone knows I mean the 38 Geary bus, because we care about transit in San Francisco, right? And not the 38 something rather freeway or whatever. But that being said, what's interesting, if you keep on going north on 5, it becomes I-5 up in Oregon and Washington. So you can start off in San Diego, start on the 5, keep on to 5, and then go to I-5 and never leave the highway. So now how about right here in the Bay Area? Are there ways that we can be snobby even right here in the Bay Area? Oh, yes, there is. For this one, I'm going to turn to Eddie Izzard.
So, San Francisco, not San Fran, no, apparently not. I didn't know that, you know. I would have said San Fran, but again, no, not San Fran, no. Or, what's the other one, you know? Oh, Frisco, you don't like that either. And you're a city of snakes, I see, as well.
Right. right. So yeah, we don't like Frisco. Yeah. And later on in this sketch, he talks about, oh, you like to be called the city, right? Which I think we do just to piss off New Yorkers, right? I mean, only San Francisco and New York would have the chutzpah to say the city with a capital T and C, right? Like there's no other cities. Yeah, yeah, so, yeah. And oh, that's true, the city of London as well, that's true. Yeah, the original pretentious people in London. So it turns out this is not a new thing. This is hundreds of years, at least 150 odd years old. So who here knows about Emperor Norton? Any? Yeah, okay, yes, you nerds. All right, so by the way, if you know of anyone who can speak intelligently about Emperor Norton, Bart would love to do a nerd night about this if possible. So Emperor Norton, for those of you that don't know, he was a guy that basically went crazy, proclaimed himself Emperor of the United States and Protector of Mexico, printed his own money, started issuing like imperial proclamations. But here's the crazy part. Is San Franciscans accepted his money and started following his proclamations, right? This shows you that like way back in the 19th century, San Francisco was already home to a lot of like accepting of weirdos, right? And you can see that even this guy, you know, one of his early proclamations was calling Frisco an abominable word and saying that it was a high misdemeanor to say Frisco, right? So this is an old, old shibboleth that real San Franciscans do not say Frisco, all right? You're probably familiar with this one. All right, this is a common shibboleth for telling, you know, just like the in front of a freeway is a SoCal thing, this is a big NorCal thing, is saying hella. So those of you that didn't grow up in Northern California probably know about the main use of this, which is as a synonym for very, kind of like the Boston wicked, right? You know, so you can say, oh my God, that first speaker was hella boring, or, you know. But what you may not know is that this also is a synonym for a lot of. So like there were hella people there at Nerd Night, right? And I think that explains the etymology. It probably came from hell of a lot of, right? And then only later became very. So there, now you can tell the difference between true Northern California people and the posers, because they'll only know that a lot of. And now you're in on the secret. So here's another one, especially for the natives. We're gonna do a call and response. Farms in Berkeley? Oh, okay, so everyone that didn't move, you're all carpetbaggers. Those are the real natives there. It said move. All right, so there used to be this radio ad, I think it ran from the 70s through the 90s, where they said, farms in Berkeley? Moo. So this one doesn't just mark you as having been from the Bay Area, but also during that time period. You know, I'm not sure if like high school kids growing up today would hear that radio ad very much. Sorry, yeah, they're like, what's radio? Yeah, is it on my iPod? Yeah, so, all right, so this one I think will be controversial. What do we think this one is pronounced as? Valencia, yeah, okay. So Valencia, so did anyone say Valencia? Anyone, a few? Okay, so old school San Franciscans call this Valencia, right? There's my friend's dad who grew up on Valencia, as he says it, in the 50s calls it that, right? So, and we might say, well, yeah, but Valencia is more correct, you know, but very few people say Valencia like the way they would say it in Spain, right? And where it gets even more ridiculous is places like this, right? Like, we'll laugh at people that say Vallejo. Oh, I went to Vallejo. Oh, you're not from here, right? But nobody says Vallejo, right? Right? I've never heard Vallejo, yeah. So, I mean, and this is this correct way of mispronouncing, especially in California, it's mostly Spanish, right? But in other places, you know, I've heard of places in Illinois where the name Illinois itself is mispronounced French, right? I remember Ringo, the third speaker, I was visiting him and I said, oh, I went to this great place in Chula Vista. And he was like, no, you went to Chula Vista. Yeah. What's interesting is La Jolla is pronounced with the ya sound rather than La Jolla or La Jolla or whatever. All right. So anyway, so those are all sort of geographic shibboleths, right? What about distinguishing not just where you're from, but how you were raised? So this next one, this is what, when I was in eighth grade, I had this English teacher named Mrs. Jigginess, and she would say, now we're going to distinguish between the truly educated and the pseudo-educated, all right? And so these are things like this. So I'm putting educated in scare quotes for reasons here. So this is an example from Trader Joe's. It says 12 items or less. Now, some people will say that when you say less, you're referring to mass nouns. And if you want to refer to a count noun, it has to be fewer. So they prefer 12 items or fewer. And in fact, if you notice, Safeway changed their signs to say whatever it is, items or fewer now, because of people writing in and complaining. But it turns out that this was basically made up in the 18th century, that that Les has referred to count nouns as well since basically the dawn of English, and they kind of made up this rule, and now it basically only serves as a shibboleth to know whether you know this sort of arbitrary rule that doesn't really apply to most, you know, at least conversational English. One rule that got made up fairly recently, which is really stupid, is this thing about splitting infinitives, right? So they say, oh, you can't put any words between the to and the, you know, the verb itself, right? And the only justification for this is the Latin doesn't split infinitives. And there's a reason Latin doesn't split infinitives, because they're one word in Latin, right? So forcing English to follow Latin grammar makes about as much sense as, you know, making everyone wear togas just because they did it then, right? So therefore, the Star Trek, you know, they would want it to be something like to go boldly, where, you know, it just sounds stupid, right? Now, this is one that's probably a bit controversial. Who thinks that this sentence is grammatically correct? Oh, sorry, yeah, so it says, was it your mother or father who forgot to bring their glasses? So, people who think it's correct? All right, a handful. How many people think it's incorrect? Okay, so about equal there. So, I side with the people that think it's correct, right? So, there has, they call this the singular they, but really it's a they that refers to when you either don't know the gender or the number of what it's referring to, right? And really, this has gone, again, back to pretty much the dawn of English. Like, Shakespeare used it, Austin used it. If you look online, you'll find they have, like, hundreds of instances where Jane Austen uses this kind of construction. And in particular, like, particularly if you replace there with his or her, it's clearly trying to refer to one or the other, and his or her is really messy. I often find myself just avoiding these kind of things just because I know that some people do care about this as a shibboleth, basically. So I don't want them to think that I'm uncultured or whatever. But really, I think we need to get on board with the so-called singular they that we need to get. But that's my own personal, you know, political belief. We can talk red states and blue states later. I will say the one thing which I totally will look down on you with my nerdly, you know, smite is people that screw up this. Right, and just as bad, if not worse, is the ITS, IT apostrophe S. Oh, like even in emails and chat, I'm like, good God, did you go to school? Like, what is wrong with you? Just I'm at least judgmental about this. So just warning, if any of you, you know, work with me or receive emails, then just please try and avoid it so that I won't be judgmental towards you. So here's a bunch of other places to learn more. There's the reference to the original shibboleth, a few other books. Actually, this other book, The Language Instinct by Steven Pinker, is a great sort of intro to sort of cognitive science and linguistics in general. And he has a chapter in here about those so-called educated shibboleths, which is pretty fun. So I just want to, in closing, say that, you know, we didn't have time to go over. There's lots of other shibboleths that distinguish you based on, you know, class and where you, like your alma mater. You can figure out where someone works, their profession, their religion sometimes. Those, you know, there's lots of these things that work out. And I hope that you sort of, you know, use them for good and not for evil. You know, just because now you sort of can be like, you know, Henry Higgins or Sherlock Holmes and be like, oh, so I see that you are therefore an unemployed dentist from Kentucky because of, you know, whatever. That at least that we do not stereotype based on these, right? You know, so just because you hear someone say the 280, you don't suddenly say, oh, well, you know, therefore you're, you know, an uncultured, you know, shallow, Dodger-loving, you know, imbecile or whatever, right? You know, because you're from SoCal, right? You know, because, you know, not everyone from SoCal is those things, right? Like our third speaker, again, is from Southern California, and he's probably one of the smartest people I know and is, you know, none of those things. I don't think Ringo roots for the Dodgers, anyway. But, so again, you know, let's at least, you know, going back to Emperor Norton, let's be good San Franciscans and be accepting of everyone and their diversity and find this a neat way to learn about our fellow people rather than pigeonholing them into stereotypes. So with that, any questions? Yeah, right there. This one here?
Yeah.
Yes.
Where they identify him because he's English and he uses the three fingers we would use for three, and they say that the Germans would use these three. Do you know if that's true?
I lived in Italy for a while, and in general they do start counting with their thumbs. So the idea, if you haven't seen the movie, there's this scene where this British double agent who's trying to pass for a Nazi holds up his hand like this to order three beers, And everyone in the bar goes silent because they know that he's an imposter, right? Because a real German would go like this, starting to count with one with the thumb. So in general, if that's on the continent in general, I don't know if it's every country in continental Europe, but in general, I think that's the case. A lot of people pointed that out when I was telling them I was giving this talk. They're like, oh, you have to watch Inglourious Basterds. Yes, sir?
Oxford comma, shibboleth or good taste?
I'm sorry?
Oxford comma, shibboleth.
Oh, the Oxford comma. I'm in favor of the so-called Oxford comma. For those of you that don't know, it's putting the comma before the and in a long, you know, in a long list. But there's good arguments for and against, I would say that, so... in that case, it's a little harder because there's sort of educated people on both sides of the debate. A lot of the other ones I mentioned, like, it's mostly, well, I guess there's, so in many of these cases, there's sort of three groups. So, like, one example is what you say for, like, a name and yourself. So, you know, the sort of uneducated people will say, oh, Cindy and me went to the store. And it'll be like, oh, no, it's Cindy and I, right? But then people that think they're educated will say, oh, they gave the book to Cindy and I. Which is equally wrong, right? Because they're hyper-correcting, right? So, you know, there's sort of these weird cases where, you know, a shibboleth can become, like, overly applied or whatever. So, you know, I think that one might be like that. Anybody up at the top? No? All right, this guy right here?
The Oxford Dictionary recently disavowed the Oxford comma.
Okay, there you go. So he's saying the Oxford Dictionary disavowed the Oxford comma. So I know that Oxford also is in favor of the American spelling with... Z's instead of S's in some words, so that's another where Oxford special, yeah. Or Z, sorry, yeah.
People say, what? Where does that come from?
Where does what come from?
Pronouncing the H. What?
Oh, what instead of what?
Yeah.
I think that's mostly a dialect thing. I know there was a Family Guy where Stewie keeps saying, cool whip. But I don't know where that, I think it... I'm guessing that some more British dialects will aspirate the H there, but I'm not up to speed on those dialects. So I think I missed someone here. That guy there?
So what's the origin of putting an and in front of history? And history, what is that all about?
And history?
Yes.
I'm not sure about that one, yeah.
A lot of people put a and before H's that aren't like ours.
Oh, a and before an H, yeah. So.
Like and historical.
Oh, and historic occasion? Yeah. I think in some cases it's just... So there's some of these shibboleths are more written. Like, so like the there, it's ones. That doesn't come up at all in spoken speech, right? So, but this would be a case where probably you're writing and it looks better writing than when you say it out loud. Sometimes also people pronounce it.
It's French.
Yeah, there's a French tradition of certain H's you do what they call édition with and some they don't and so forth. So... I think a lot of it comes from that, yeah. So, yeah?
A lot of your examples
are sort of... How many are, like, traditionally derived? So you're saying, the question's about, these were all sort of things that you can intuit, but how about shibboleths that people make up intentionally? So yeah, obviously, especially like fraternities, secret societies will make up sort of passwords, that kind of thing. In the classic definition of shibboleth, it would be something that you might sort of throw into an everyday conversation, maybe, as opposed to like a secret handshake. But yeah, obviously, shibboleths can be constructed as well as kind of derived. So I think that's just about the time we have. So thank you very much.